Greetings. My name is Dr. Israel Loken, and I'm the chair of the Bible and Theology departments at the College of Biblical Studies. And it is my privilege to welcome you to the 2017-18 College of Biblical Studies Commencement Ceremony. In a few moments, the board, faculty, and students will process in from the rear of the building. So please clear all the aisles so that they can easily walk in. Also, please silence all of your cell phones. And without any further ado, I would like to ask you to please rise for the academic processional.
Good morning. If you would, please remain standing for a moment of praise and worship. We're going to sing to the Lord and lift high the name of our Christ in this place. Amen? Amen? So this is a time of participation. The lyrics will be on the screen, and we invite you to sing along with us. We're going to clap and have a great time. All right? Amen. Come on, let's start right here. Everybody, right here. All over this room. Everything that has breath, let's give our God praise. It's a familiar song. You already know it. Join in with him. Here we go. I just want to praise you. Come on, sing with us. Forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory and honor, they all to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Come on, let's all sing it together. I just want to praise you forever.
Forever.
That's it. And ever.
And ever.
And ever.
And ever.
For all you've done for me. Blessings and glory.
Blessings and glory.
And honor.
And honor.
They all
belong to you.
Thank you, Jesus,
for blessing.
If you didn't know it, you know it by now. Come on, let's everybody. Come on. I just want to praise you forever,
forever
and ever
and ever
and ever,
and ever
for all you've done for me. We're addressing our God. Blessings and glory.
Blessings and glory.
And honor.
They all belong
that's it.
To
We're gonna
you.
Say it again. Blessings and
glory
and honor.
They all belong
Say it
to
one
you.
More time.
Blessings and glory
and honor.
They all belong to you.
So we simply say, thank you, Jesus. Can you say that with us? Come on, everybody, say it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lift your voice in this house today and declare,
thank you, Jesus.
God's been so good to us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, let's tell him, Lord, I love you. Tell him,
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you. Tell him, Lord, I love you. Stay there, Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I praise 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 you.
Lord, I bless you. Today we bless you.
Lord, I 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 bless you.
Hey,
thank you, Jesus, for blessing me.
For blessing me.
Now will you put your hands together and open your mouth and shout unto our God with a voice of triumph, because he is so good. Come on, open your mouth and bless our great God. Congratulations to the graduates. You know this better than anyone else, that God is able to do what he said he would do. Our God is able. Our God is able. Another familiar song, we invite you to sing along with us. Exceedingly, come on, abundantly, above all. Y'all know this, that you could ask or think, according to the power that worketh in you. So what do we know? That God is able to do just what he said he would do. And what else? He's gonna fulfill every promise to you. So the word of encouragement is, don't give up on God, 'cause he won't
give up on you. Why? He's able. Come on, can you lift your hands in this place? Can we celebrate the greatness of our God? Come on. Oh, he's able. Hallelujah. God is able to do. Everybody, let's come on in and sing it together. Come on, God is able. Let's say,
God is able to do just what he said
he would do.
That's it.
He's gonna fulfill
every promise
to you. Don't give up on God.
Don't give up on God.
Cause he won't give up.
He won't give.
Come on, everybody, let's go get it. He's able.
He's able.
Yeah, he's able. He's able. Lord, we bless you in this house. You are great. You're awesome and amazing. He's able.
He's able.
God, you're able. Yes, you are. Oh. Come on, let's lift it.
God is able to do just what he said
he would do.
He's gonna fulfill. He's gonna fulfill.
He's able. Say it again. He's able. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We know that our God is able. So let's moment and just declare his greatness. Everybody right here. Say he's able.
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 Come on. He's able.
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 God is.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able.
To do exceedingly.
He's able.
And abundantly.
He's able.
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 Our God is.
He's able.
So able.
Oh yes, he is. He will pick you up, turn your life around. He's able.
He's able.
Oh yes, he is.
He's able.
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 Don't give up on God. Cause he won't give up on you. Don't give up on God. Cause he won't give up on you. One more time, say he's able.
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 He's able. Can you say that?
Look someone in the face and just encourage them today. Tell them,
don't give up on God.
That's it.
Cause he won't give up.
You never know who may need this word of encouragement today.
Don't give up on God. Cause he won't
give up on you.
Say it again. Don't give up on God.
Don't give up on God.
Cause he won't give up. Cause he won't.
Hey,
don't give up on God.
Cause he won't give up.
Cause he's able.
Come on and bless our able God. Hallelujah.
Let me ask the gentlemen to remove your hats. Shall we pray? God, you're so able. And now, Father, we want to come and join the four living creatures, the 24 elders, the myriads and myriads and thousands of angels that are crying out, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, he that was and he that is and he that is to come. Father, we want to celebrate with them, with you, these graduates that have come to this stage of life. Now, Father, you brought them this far. We're trusting that you'll carry them further on. Father, pray for the speaker, that you'd anoint him. Father, we pray, oh God, that everything will be done for your glory. So we love you and we pray. You ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, Dr. Ivory Varner, for that excellent prayer to get us started today. And I want to thank Reverend Chad Brawley. Wasn't the praise and worship wonderful this morning? I also want to thank the St. Thomas Alumni Pipers for the exceptional Bad Piper music as well today. Thank you so much. It truly is a thrill today to welcome you to the College of Biblical Studies 2017-18 Commencement Ceremony. My name is Dr. Joe Parle. I'm the Academic Dean of the College of Biblical Studies. And you might be wondering, well, where is the president today? Our president, Dr. Bill Blocker, has done the exceptional thing that leaders do, and he put his family first this morning. He is celebrating the graduation of his wife, Zelda Blocker, at Dallas Theological Seminary, which was scheduled on the same day as ours. So he's unfortunately unable to make it, but he said he would be praying for this time today. So I will be standing in his place. It is a delight to have you with us on this joyous and momentous day. I want to introduce the individuals who are joining me on the stage. To my right and your left is Dr. Lisa Stewart, who is the Dean of Students, Associate Vice President of Enrollment and Student Services. Then we have Paul Keith, who is our Vice President of Administration, and he's our Chief Operating Officer. And then next to him, we have Reverend Dr. Robert Crummy, Sr., who is the President of Carver Bible College in Atlanta, Georgia. And then to my left, we have Dr. Ivory Varner, who has been our longtime CBS Board Chair and did a wonderful job of leading us in prayer. And then next to him, we have Mr. Chris Fontaine, who is our registrar. Today, we want to honor our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and bring glory to God our Father. As I was speaking to Reverend Dr. Crummy beforehand, he said, I like how you put the graduates in the middle. And we also want this to be a day that honors you, graduates, for all of your hard work and effort. This is a time to rejoice. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will be glad on it. In it. To our guests, we hope that you will be blessed during this time and that you will enjoy witnessing the milestone of this event for our graduates. Graduates, you made it! I knew you could do it, and as your academic dean, it is my privilege to acknowledge this accomplishment in your life today. But there are some other people that we want to acknowledge. First and most importantly, we want to thank God the Father, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit for God's unceasing faithfulness to the College of Biblical Studies, and especially towards these candidates of graduation. For those of you that are joining us today as guests, there is one gift that many of our graduates, if you haven't received it already, I'm confident would want you to receive today. There's one gift you could receive that actually would give something great to our graduates, and that is the gift of salvation. If you are not aware, the Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We all are sinners and we cannot save ourselves. There's nothing we can do to earn or deserve what God wants to freely give us. And so as a result of our sin, we are separated from God. And so God had an issue because he's a holy God, but he's also a merciful God. And because he's holy, he could not accept sinful people into his eternal dwelling place. But because he's merciful, he wanted to create a way for us to get there. So out of his grace, he sent his son, Jesus Christ, fully God and fully man, perfect in every way, to die in our place for our sins. I only have one son. And if my son's blood was the cure for cancer, I wouldn't sacrifice him for anybody. I love my son that much. However, God loves us so much that he gave his one and only son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross, to pay the penalty for our sins, and to provide a way for us to get to heaven, to be with him. And so, how can we receive this gift of eternal life? There's only one way, and that is by trusting in Jesus Christ alone and his finished work on the cross for eternal life. There's nothing you can do to earn or deserve salvation. All of your works, as great as they are and as wonderful as they might be, because of our sin, we have no way of getting there on our own. And so if you have not trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I would encourage you to talk to one of these graduates about how to do that and what that means. To find a church home where you can learn more about his word and to continue to walk and study his word daily, so you can learn what it means to live the Christian life. I'm sure that for many of our graduates, any family or friend that does not know this wonderful news, good news about eternal salvation, would love for you to know that today. I would also like to thank Houston's First Baptist Church and Pastor Greg Mott for allowing us to use this beautiful facility. Can we thank him together? Additionally, I want to express our thanks to our exceptional Board of Trustees and Regents. Thank you very much for being here today. Our CBS Women's Partnership, our CBS Alumni, and the President's Advisory Council for Excellence. We thank you for how you serve CBS loyally and generously. We are grateful for you. If you are in that group of people that I just announced, I would like to ask you to stand and remain standing. So if our Board of Trustees, anyone involved in the Women's Partnership, or the President's Advisory Council for Excellence, and if you would remain standing, please. There's another group of people that I know that probably are important part of this process today, and I know that you, the graduates, love them, but they were also challenged by them. So I would like to ask the CBS faculty to please rise and allow us to thank you and remain standing. I've had the chance to work with them for quite some time, and I can just say your commitment to Jesus Christ and his word is nothing short of exemplary, and I thank you for what you've invested in our students and your faithfulness towards them. There's another group of people that we want to recognize today, and I know many of these students have pastors that are here today who have shepherded them and guided them. And so if you happen to be a pastor of one of these graduates, would you please stand and remain standing? We also recognize that no one can complete the rigors of a college education. Pastors, you can remain standing. No one can complete the rigors of a college education without a loving and supportive spouse. And so if you are a wife or husband of one of our graduates today, would you please stand? And please remain standing. If you would please remain standing, all of you, and tomorrow's Mother's Day, so we want to recognize the mothers of our spouse and of our graduates. So if you are a parent, a mother, or a father of one of our graduates, if you would please stand and remain standing. Happy Mother's Day to the mothers in the house. Brothers and sisters, step-parents, if you're any way related, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, if you would please remain standing. Stand and remain standing. If you are a friend of one of the graduates, if you would please remain standing, friend or associate, child of the graduate in any way. Graduates, this is what it took to get you here. The support of all of these people. I would also like to ask the CBS staff to please stand and remain standing. So if you are part of the CBS staff, I'd like you to stand and remain standing. Want to thank our staff for all their loyal work. Graduates, this is what it took. So I'd like now the graduates to stand and thank those who helped them to get to this point. Thank you. You all may be seated. This year, I want to publicly recognize one of our professors for a significant milestone. Dr. Nicholas Ellen has been awarded a senior professor position this year, which recognizes those with over 20 years of teaching experience at CBS and an earned doctorate. Dr. Nicholas Ellen, would you please stand so we can recognize you? Now, you know, he couldn't have done that without the loving support of a wonderful wife, who also happens to be one of our professors. So I'm going to ask Dr. Vanessa Ellen to please come to the stage to make some special recognitions.
Thank you, Dr. Parle. As a part of our 2014-2019 strategic plan, the College of Biblical Studies emphasized a strategic focus on women, which included a desire to develop a Bachelor of Science in Women's Ministry. Today we see the fruit of that effort, in that we are celebrating our first graduates from the Bachelor of Science in Women's Ministry program. Additionally, in that same strategic plan, we proposed a Bachelor of Science in Christian leadership that would be taught completely in the Spanish language. Today, we are also celebrating our first graduates of that program. And finally, we are also having our first commencement ceremony after Hurricane Harvey swept through Houston, leaving devastation for many. CBS has raised funds for scholarships and other financial assistance for some of our students who were affected by Hurricane Harvey. Some of those students are graduating today. I would like to ask if any of our graduates who had homes or families affected by Hurricane Harvey to please stand so that we can recognize your perseverance in the midst of such challenges. Would you please stand if you were affected? Hallelujah. Additionally, we would like to recognize the CBS staff, faculty, friends, and family of the graduates who are still recovering from this historic storm. If your home flooded due to Hurricane Harvey, would you please stand so that we can recognize your presence here after the storm? Hallelujah. Thank God. Hallelujah. And finally, we would like to recognize our first responders who worked during Hurricane Harvey. If you are a first responder, would you please stand? Hallelujah. Thank you. You may be seated. And now, for the reading of God's Word, I give you Dr. Marvin McNeese, Chair of General Education.
Please stand for the reading of God's word. Por favor, póngase de pie para la lectura de las palabras. Gentlemen, please remove your hats. Caballeros, favor de quizás quitarse su birrete. Exodus 35, 30 through 35. Then Moses said to the Israelites, "See, the Lord has chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and he has filled him with the Spirit of God, with wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, and with all kinds of skills, to make artistic designs for work in gold, silver, and bronze, to cut stones and set stones, to work in wood, and to engage in all kinds of artistic crafts. And he has given him both, he's given both him and Oholiab, son of Ahisamach, the tribe of Judah, the ability to teach others." Exodus 35, versículos 30 a 35. Entonces Moisés dijo a los hijos de Israel, "Mirad, Jehová ha llamado por nombre a Bezalel, hijo de Uri, hijo de Ur, de la tribu de Judá, y lo ha llenado del Espíritu de Dios con sabiduría, entendimiento, conocimiento y toda habilidad de artesano, para hacer diseños artísticos y para trabajar en oro, plata y bronce, en el tallado de piedras para engastar, en el tallado de madera y para realizar toda clase de labor artística. Él ha puesto en su corazón la capacidad para enseñar, tanto él como Oholiab, hijo de Ahisamach, de la tribu de Dan. Los ha llenado con sabiduría de corazón para realizar toda obra de artesano, diseñador y bordador de material azul, púrpura, carmesí y lino y de tejedor, para que realicen toda labor y hagan diseños artísticos." Thank you. Please be seated. Gracias. Pueden sentarse.
I'd like to bring Professor France Brown to come and introduce our student speaker.
Thank you, Dr. Prawl. I'd like to ask our student speaker, Clement Hall, to make his way to the stage. Clement Hall is a native Houstonian who is zealous about integrating biblical ethics into the common culture of his city through the preaching of the Word of God. For 6 years, he has served as senior pastor of the Second Advent Baptist Church, a local congregation that works to prepare souls for the return of Christ through practical application of biblical truth. Clement is a graduate of Sterling High School in Houston and earned an Associate of Science degree from Houston Community College. His commitment to faithful biblical proclamation led him to discontinue his studies at the University of Houston and to pursue pastoral ministries at the College of Biblical Studies. Clement has proven to be excellent in his studies as well as in ministry skills. In 2017, Clement received second place in the National Haddon W. Robinson Biblical Preaching Competition presented by the Evangelical Homiletic Society. Today, Clement is joined by his wife, Cinquenta, and their one-month-old son, Zachary. And there. Good to have you. Clement would continue his theological studies by enrolling at Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you preacher, pastor, Pastor Clement Hall.
Permit me, if you would, to thank Professor Brown for that wonderful introduction. I'd also like to take a moment to acknowledge the CBS administration, members of the board, friends of the college, faculty and staff, my fellow graduates, and everyone present this morning. It is an honor to stand before you as the student speaker of the 2017-2018 College of Biblical Studies Commencement Ceremony. This is a bit surreal because growing up, I never imagined that I would have the prestigious privilege to stand before a college class to deliver a commencement speech. Perhaps this moment was never a figment of my imagination, because as the youngest of five children, I was naturally the slowest, the weakest, and obviously the shortest of the five. As a result of this reality, when my siblings and I would engage in extracurricular activities such as basketball, football, and or baseball, they would brutally beat me, little brother, every time. There was one game, however, that my siblings and I would play that I would brutally beat them every time. This game is internationally known as the legendary Simon Says. I suppose that I was able to overcome my siblings when playing Simon Says because, unlike football, Simon Says is not a game that is interested in the ferociousness of your foot speed. Unlike basketball, Simon Says is not a game that is interested in the width of your wingspan. And unlike baseball, Simon Says is not a game that is interested in the abnormal strength in your hamstring. Because all you need in order to be successful when playing Simon Says is to have the ability to follow instructions. Just as a person's ability can position them to be successful when playing Simon Says, it has been brought to my attention in 28 and a half years of living now that your ability to follow instructions can also position you to be successful in life and ministry. Therefore, my fellow graduates, as we prepare to walk across this stage straight into a life of ministry, let us never forget that we can be successful in our lives and in our ministries if we develop the ability to follow instructions. As we walk across this stage, straight into a life of ministry, let us never forget that our ability to follow instructions is what got us to this point, and our ability to follow instructions will take us beyond this point. Therefore, the question that should pierce the cerebral cortex of our frontal lobe this morning is, how do you and I, my fellow graduates, position ourselves to be successful in life and ministry? King Solomon, the son of King David, answers this question in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 4, verse number 1, when he says, "Hear, O sons, the instruction of a father, and give attention that you may gain understanding." Tightly tucked within the confines of this one verse are two practical principles that you, my fellow graduates, and I should follow as we prepare to transition from the seat of a student to the stands of a teacher. First, if we are going to position ourselves to be successful in life and ministry, it requires that we live the lessons that we have learned from our instructors. Hear, O sons, the instruction of a father, and give attention that you may gain understanding. The word hear in Proverbs 4:1 comes from the Hebrew word shema. It literally means to lend your ears to the instruction of an instructor with the intent of doing what they instructed you to do. It's the picture of an athlete who positions themselves to defeat their opponent by lending their ears to the playbook of their coach. It's the picture of an employee who positions himself for a promotion by doing the policies and procedures of his employer. It's the picture of a student who positions themselves to be successful in a classroom by lending their ears to the instructions of their instructor.
But what good does it do an athlete to lend his ear to the playbook of his coach? And what good does it do an employee to lend their ear to the policies and procedures of their employer? And what good does it do a student to lend their ear to the instructions of their instructor if they do not intend on doing what their instructor has instructed them to do? For the past few years or so, my fellow graduates, we have lent our ears to the smooth speech of Dr. Sullivan, who taught us that prayer does not work, but that God works through prayer. But for the past few years or so, we have lent our ears to the boldness of Professor Brown, who taught us that faithful biblical exposition begins with a commitment to Bible study methods. For the past few years or so, we have lent our ears to the lectures of Dr. Loken, who taught us to appreciate the words of the wisdom literature. For the past few years or so, we have lent our ears to all of the College of Biblical Studies professors who taught us something to help us get to this point. But what good is consuming all of the information that they taught us if we do not plan on doing anything that we have learned over the course of these few years? Therefore, my fellow graduates, let us not be so proud that we walk across this stage straight into a life of ministry while we leave all of the knowledge that we accumulated at the threshold of a classroom door. We ought to take what we have consumed here at the College of Biblical Studies and walk into a world of ministry while living the lessons that we have learned from our instructors. It's because it's very dangerous, ladies and gentlemen, to abandon what you have learned. I learned this when I was about 6 or 7 years of age. I was run over by a 6,000-pound van. Wait a minute. Before you feel compassion for my pain, please hear my story. The sun was shining. Not a cloud in the sky, grass was green, birds chirping, flowers blooming. It was the perfect day for children to go outside and play. My brothers and I ran into my mother's room and begged her to allow us to go outside to enjoy such a wonderful day. After asking her several times, she finally agreed to allow us to go outside, but she did not let us go outside without first giving us her instructions. She told my oldest brother, Chris, watch your brothers. Sean, stay out of trouble. Clement, stay in my yard. But by the time the screen door swung open, the instructions of our mother began to leak from our ears as water leaks from a leaky faucet. We got outside and Chris was not watching his brothers. Sean was in all kind of trouble and no, Clement was not in the yard. I was about a block or so from my home when a van runs the stop sign and hits me off of my bike, runs over me with two tires, and then I'm rushed to the hospital. I wasn't rushed to the hospital because she ran the stop sign. I was rushed to the hospital because I did not listen to the instructions of my mother. If I would have stayed in the yard as my mother had instructed me to do, I would have been enjoying a beautiful day. But instead, I spent 3 days laying in a hospital bed. And months later, trying to recover fully from the injuries that I had accumulated. In a real sense, ladies and gentlemen, if we do not listen to the instructions of our instructors, we'll find ourselves being burdened down by ministry instead of enjoying the fruits of our labor. In addition to hearing, notice with me in Proverbs 4:1, hear, O sons, that Solomon, King Solomon, directs his imperatives specifically to his sons as the children of a king. It is safe to assume that Solomon's sons were taught by the best teachers. It was safe to assume that Solomon's sons were trained by the best tutors. It was safe to assume that Solomon's sons received the best education that money could buy. Just as Solomon's sons received the best education that money could buy, you and I, my fellow graduates, as students of the College of Biblical Studies, have received the best education that money could buy. But what good is receiving the best education that money could buy if you do not live the best education that we have received? In addition to living the lessons of our instructors, if we are going to place ourselves in a position to be successful in life, in ministry, King Solomon offers us one more thing that we must do and know to do so. Live the lessons of our instructors, but also, or lastly, learn to sit in silence before you stand to speak. One of the misconceptions of a commencement service is that it gives the impression that learning has somehow come to an end. But Solomon destroys this misunderstood idea in the latter half of Proverbs 4:1 when he says, "And give attention that you may gain understanding." At first glance, it appears to be a parallel statement, "Hear and give attention." But a closer look at the text proves that this is not a parallel statement as much as it is a perpendicular statement, because one depends on the other. To hear implies doing what you know, but to give attention implies knowing what you do. You can't do what you know until you know what to do. Therefore, Solomon says, "Hear, O sons," and then he says, "Give attention first." Before you start running off to do ministry, you better not give up your seat as a student, because you need to know what to do in order to progress in life. Unfortunately, some of us will walk out of this room thinking that we know everything. But if you got good sense, then you ought to know that you have learned, that we have learned a lot of things at the College of Biblical Studies. We know how to exegete a passage. We know how to research material to find out the answer that we want to know. We have learned several things at the College of Biblical Studies, but in all that we have learned, we should know that there's still much to be learned. The American poet Maya Angelou captured this idea on an episode of Oprah's Masterclass when she stated at 82 years of age, she was still learning. This woman, who people come to her for advice, stated that she was still learning. This woman who have stood on stages and spoken to masses of people stated, "I'm still learning." She captured the idea that you ought never give up your seat as a student, even though you have transitioned to the stance of a teacher. Every once in a while, you ought to take a break from speaking and sit down and let somebody speak to you. We can position ourselves to be successful in life and ministry, my fellow graduates, if we live the lessons that we have learned from our instructors. We can position ourselves to be successful in life and ministry if we learn to sit in silence before we stand to speak. 18 years before I was born, the Dallas Cowboys won the 1971 Super Bowl under the leadership of head coach Tom Landry and starting quarterback Roger Staubach. If you know anything about the 1970s, obviously I don't. But what I hear is when Roger got to the league, he was a hot-headed quarterback who was determined to do his own thing. The coach would tell him, "Roger, throw the ball," and Roger would take off running. The coach would tell Roger, "Run the ball," and Roger would throw the ball out of bounds. Roger just would not do what his coach told him to do, and as a result, the Dallas Cowboys were losing badly. But all of a sudden, out of nowhere, Roger Staubach and the Dallas Cowboys, the 1971 Dallas Cowboys, are being handed the Super Bowl championship. A local reporter ran up to Roger after the game had concluded and said, "Roger, tell me the secret that got you this success." It was then that Roger said something that pierced my theological intellect. He said, "There is no secret. The only thing that we did to get to this point was do what our coach told us to do. When he told us to throw the ball, we just threw the ball. When he told us to run the ball, we just ran the ball. And because we did what he told us to do, we made it to this point." All I'm trying to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, as I sit in my seat, is that if you want to position yourself to be successful in life in ministry, you got to learn how to throw the ball when the coach say throw it. You got to learn how to take off running when the coach say take off running. You have to position yourself to be successful in life in ministry. No, this is no easy task. To place yourself in a position to be successful is not an easy task, but when the road gets rough, we ought to remember the poetic words of Edgar Guest in his poem, "It Couldn't Be Done." Edgar Guest says, somebody said that it couldn't be done, but he with a chuckle replied that maybe it couldn't, but he wouldn't be one who would say so until he tried. So he buckled it in with a bit of a grin on his face. If he worried at all, he hit it. He started to sing as he tackled the thing that couldn't be done, and he did it. There are thousands to tell you that it cannot be done. There are thousands to prophesy failure. There are thousands to point out to you one by one the dangers that wait to excel you, but just buckled it in with a bit of a grin. Just take off your coat and go to it. Just start to sing as you tackle the thing that couldn't be done, and you'll do it.
Amen. What a word. Come on, let's thank God for him one more time. You may be seated. Congratulations to all that are graduating. This song is the song of your heart, the song of your prayer to God. It's your commitment to your call. It's your commitment to who you are and what you're doing. And we thank God for you.
I give myself away. I give myself away. I give myself away. So you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Oh, I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Oh God, I give myself away so you can use me. So here I am, here I stand, Lord, my life is in your hands. Lord, I'm longing to see your desires revealed in me. I give myself away.
That's our prayer today and our commitment.
I give myself away
so you,
so you
can use me.
Can use
I give myself,
give myself away.
I belong to you, God. I give
myself myself away.
So you,
can use me.
So take my heart and take my life as a living sacrifice. All my dreams and all my plans, Lord, I place them in your hands. Can you sing it with us this time? I give myself away. We declare that today, God. We give ourselves to you.
I give myself away.
So you,
can use me.
I give myself
away.
To you I belong, so I give myself to you. Come on, let's sing that together. Declare
my life is not my own.
Tell the Father,
to you I belong.
That's it,
I give myself,
I give myself, I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. Father, I give myself away. All that I am is yours. I give myself away so you can use me. Will you sing that to the Father? Tell him, I give myself away. Can we lift that in this house? What better time?
I give myself away.
So you can use me.
So you
can use me. I give myself away. I give
myself away.
So you can use me. Let's say it again.
I give myself away.
My life is not my own.
I give myself away.
I give myself to you. I give
myself away.
God, you've been so good.
I give myself away.
So you can use me. I give myself
away.
So you can use me, Lord. I give myself
away.
I'll use what you've given me to reach your people.
I give myself away.
So you can use me. Come on, say it again, everybody.
I give myself away.
My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself,
so
give myself.
Oh,
I give myself away. Oh God,
I give myself away.
So you can use me. Come on, just tell God thank you.
First, want to thank Reverend Clement Hall for making a man-made game, Simon Says, reveal to us truth with respect to what God says. So thank you for that message this afternoon. My name is Paul Keith, and I'm the Vice President for Administration and Chief Operating Officer at CBS. and it's my privilege to introduce to you our commencement speaker, the Reverend Dr. Robert Wayne Crummy Sr. Reverend Robert Crummy is the fourth child of the late Edwin and Doris Crummy and a native of Washington, D.C. He graduated with a B.S. in Economics and Business Administration from Benedict College and with a THM from Dallas Theological Seminary, where he served as the president of his class and was recently invited to be on the Board of Trustees of DTS. He is in the final stage of completing his doctorate of ministry at Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary, and he also holds an honorary doctorate from the Denver Institute of Urban Studies. After serving as a grants management specialist at the NIH, he did a four-year stint as a missionary with CRU, formerly Campus Crusade for Christ. Reverend Crummy accepted the invitation to serve as the vice president of Carver College in September 1996, and in May 2000, the Carver Board of Trustees elected him the fifth president of the college. Under his leadership, the college enlarged its footprint in 2006 from 2.5 acres to 16. He led Carver through initial accreditation in 2006 and its 10-year reaffirmation with the Association of Biblical Higher Education through 2021. He guided the college to access Title IV funding in 2010 and recently has expanded its academic offerings to include degrees in both psychology and business. His leadership also brought him a men's and women's basketball team to the college, with both enjoying competitive play in the NCCAA Division I. Reverend Crummy was licensed to preach by the Dr. David Durham at Mount Sinai Baptist Church in Washington, D.C., and ordained to the gospel ministry by Dr. Tony Evans at Oak Cliff Bible Fellowship in Dallas, Texas. In 1998, Reverend Crummy was elected pastor of Mount Calvary Missionary Baptist Church in College Park, Georgia. His vision for Mount Calvary is growing the church to glorify God, a vision that has expanded both the church's ministries and membership. Mount Calvary's vision this year is desiring the King in 2018. Reverend Crummy is married to the lovely Dr. Carla Michelle Crummy, an educator and life coach. They have one son, Robert Wayne, the second, a standout athlete, and one daughter, Megan Michelle, a budding actress and gymnast. His life vision is simply to go to heaven and take as many people with him as possible. His favorite hymn is Near the Cross. And his favorite scripture is Matthew 26:36-46. Please give a warm CBS welcome to the Reverend Dr. Robert Wayne Crummy Sr.
Thank you. Good morning. Good afternoon. It's a delight to be here today and to share a word with the graduates of the College of Biblical Studies, class of 2018. Join me in giving God even more praise for them, will you? To my friend and co-laborer in higher biblical education, Dr. Bill Blocker, I want to thank him for this incredible invitation and opportunity to be here and to serve today as your commencement speaker. I want to thank your staff and your faculty and your administrative leaders for the warm hospitality that I've already enjoyed. And I bring you greetings from the sister school to CBC in Atlanta, Georgia, Carver College, as well as from Mount Calvary Missionary Baptist Church in College Park, Georgia. You know, standing here reminds me, the young fellow that stood at commencement one year and he poured his heart out as he spoke to the graduates and all of the family and friends who were there to support them. And after the commencement message, he was shaking hands with some of the guests, and one lady, this polka dot dress, came up and said, "Sir, that was a terrible commencement address." The guest preacher just kind of humbly said, "Ma'am, will you pray for me?" And she got in line a second time and came around again. And again, she said to the guest speaker, "Sir, that was a terrible message you gave." And the guest speaker just again humbly said, "Ma'am, pray for me, will you?" And lo and behold, graduates, this same lady got in line a third time. And this time, the guest speaker nudged the president on the arm and said, "That lady, this is the third time she's got in line to greet me. And each time she said what a terrible message I gave." The president said, "Look here, don't pay her no mind. She doesn't quite have it all upstairs. She just goes around repeating what everyone else is saying." So I want y'all to pray with me today. And we're going to pray that those kind of conversations do not go on around here after today's commencement message. Every eye closed, every head bowed. Father, we thank you, Lord, so much for this special day. We thank you, Lord, for these graduates and their journey. We thank you for the leadership of this school, the board, the president, the administration. We thank you for the faculty who've poured so much of themselves and your word into these graduates. And so, Lord, we pray now, and we thank you for this service and all that have transpired, this incredible worship, this powerful message from Reverend Hall. We thank you, Lord, that you have brought these graduates to this place and to this point in their life. And so, Lord, as we turn our hearts and our heads now to your word again, we pray that your word will fall upon the good soul of our hearts, and particularly their hearts, take root, grow, and manifest itself in the ministries that they'll lead and in the marketplace that some of them will go serve in. So, Lord, I pray as David prayed in that 19th Psalm and ask as he asked, that you will let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, my rock, my strength, and my redeemer. In Jesus' name, let every heart say amen. You know, ministry, graduates, is long. And ministry is hard. And some of you all who serve in ministry now and others who will enter ministry or the marketplace or wherever God sends you to serve, there'll be times when weariness will seek in. And there'll be times where you'll have to dig deep and you'll have to stay motivated. There'll be times when you all may want to even throw in the towel. But you can't do that. You're going to have to stay with your hands to the plow and continue to do what God has called you to do. And I want to just share a passage that may be familiar to some and perhaps not to others, but in Exodus chapter 35, beginning with verse 30, the Bible says, "Then Moses said to the sons of Israel, 'See, the Lord has called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Ur, of the tribe of Judah, and he hath filled him with the Spirit of God and wisdom and understanding and in knowledge and in all craftsmanship to make designs for working in gold and in silver and in bronze and in the cutting of stones, for settings and into the carving of wood, so as to perform in every inventive work. He has also put in his heart to teach both he and Aholiab, the son of Ahisamach of the tribe of Dan." I want to share for just a few moments on the thought, motivation for ministry. Motivation for ministry. Some folk are motivated by money. Others are motivated by fame. Others are motivated by prestige. you all have to have a different set of motivation. Money runs out. Fame fades. Influence is not long-lasting. And I believe the same thing that motivated Bezalel in this text can serve to motivate you and I as we enter the heavy lifting of a life of serving our Lord Jesus Christ, some vocationally in ministry and certainly others, as I've said, in the marketplace. The first observation in this text is that I believe one thing that should motivate all of us and you whenever weariness seek in is, listen, the call of God on your life. Look at verse 30. It says, "Then Moses said to the sons of Israel, 'See, the Lord has called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Ur of the tribe of Judah.'" Moses could have taken credit for himself because God had instructed Moses to do something that had never been done before, to construct the tabernacle. And mind you, this was the place where God's spirit would dwell. The tabernacle had to be excellent. It had to be done right. It had to be done well. And Moses was given the assignment. And Moses doesn't take credit for calling Bezalel. He says, "See, the Lord hath called by name Bezalel." The call is personal, it's by name. The call is also public. He says to Israel, "See." He was visible. He was known to the Israelites that God had called him. And whenever you all grow weary as graduates, when you're serving, you're going to have to keep going, first of all, because you're reminded that God called you to do it. You go to a church, yeah, there's selection committees, there's pulpit committees, but God is the one that calls a pastor. You take a position at a school like the College of Biblical Studies, yes, there's interviews, there's vetting, but God is the one that calls us. Whatever you do, you have to know that you're doing it in response to God's call. And I know that if Mayor Turner or Governor Abbott calls you on the phone and asks you, would you come to the governor's mansion and perform a certain task I need done, you would not hesitate and you would stay with it mainly because of who called you to do it. Well, know that this call is higher than any call Mayor Turner could ever make. This call is higher than any call, huh, that Governor Abbott could ever make. We're talking about the call of God on your life. But not only do I see the call of God in the life of Bezalel in this text that would keep him and you and I motivated. Secondly, I notice in this text, listen, the control of the Holy Spirit. Look at verse 31. It says, "And he has filled him with the Spirit of God." You know, it's interesting that we see the idea of filling here in the Old Testament, because normally we go where? Ephesians 5:18. And look at the imperative mood in which Paul says to the church at Ephesus, not as an option, not as a suggestion, but in the imperative mood, as a command, be filled. Don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Don't be drunk with wine, that's dissipation, that's wastefulness, but be filled. And he had to put it in that mood because there's no other way you or I can accomplish what God has called us to do unless the Spirit does it in and through us. We can't do this work in our own strength. We can't do this work with the credentials we bring to the table. In fact, God is not impressed by what we bring to the table. In fact, the less we bring sometimes, the more glory he gets. But I'm here to remind you that as God has given us the Holy Spirit to perform not only the work he's called us to do, but also to live the Christian life that he's called us to live in and through us. Somebody thank God for his Holy Spirit. Can we give God some praise for that, huh? Growing up in Washington, D.C., I remember playing hooky from school sometimes. I know y'all wouldn't know nothing about that. We would hang out in the laundromat, and teenagers, we would sometimes drink some wine. I know y'all wouldn't know nothing about that. Sometimes we would drink cheap wine. We would drink some Wild Irish Rose. I know they don't even sell out in Houston, Texas. We'd drink some Mad Dog. Somebody tell it on themselves right around there. We drink some Thunderbird. No, never mind, let me move on. See, some of you Don Perignon folk don't know that that cheap wine will mess you up. That cheap wine, hello, will make you stronger than you've ever been. Talk more than you've ever talked. And I never forget one night on Petworth Playground, I got into a argument with Saul Majette. You need to know Saul Majette was about this tall, about this wide, and he wore a tank top t-shirt to school. He was swollen all over. You don't mess with Saul Majette. But that night with that Wild Irish Rose in me, I envisioned myself with a tank top t-shirt on. I envisioned myself about this wide, and I must have lost my mind fighting Saul Majette. And the next morning in school, somebody said, "Bro, Crump, man, you beat Saul Majette." I said, "I did what?" It wasn't me, it was the wine. Huh? In fact, when I sobered up, I was scared to even see Saul Majette. But you all know that that's the way the Christian life works. That's the point Paul was making to the church at Ephesus. Because what God has called us to do, it's got to be the Holy Spirit that does it through us. We cannot do it in our own strength. Graduates, if you don't hear me say nothing else, you've got to rely on the power of the Holy Spirit to do the work of God in and through you. And I'm glad about that because you and I can mess some things up. We don't have to rely on our own strength. And that, for me, is motivating. Not only did God call me, but God has given me all that I need and given me the Holy Spirit. In the Old Testament, we know he came and he descended and he performed a work through a person and then he would leave. That's why the wine has made that record, "Lord, don't take your spirit from me." In fact, David said it, "Lord, don't take your spirit away from me." And in this dispensation, the Spirit comes to reside permanently. We know that theologically. And somebody ought to give God praise. Y'all don't know when to give God. That's an amen moment right there. You ought to be glad he ain't leaving. But that ought to be a motivating factor for you and for I, because ministry, hello somebody, is long and it's hard. And a lot of folk throwing the towel because they're relying on their own strength. They're relying on their own intellect. They're relying on their own wisdom. But praise be to God. We can rely on his Holy Spirit. Not only do I observe, we ought to be motivated by the call of God. We ought to be motivated by the control of the Holy Spirit. But listen to this third observation. You all ought to be motivated by, listen, your craftsmanship. Notice the next clause. I'm still in 31, and he is filled with the Holy Spirit of God in wisdom and understanding and in knowledge and in all craftsmanship. In other words, those, Bezalel, who worked on construction of the tabernacle, they were skilled, they were trained, they had understanding. They had wisdom, they had knowledge to do what it took to construct the tabernacle. They had spent time. They had sat under instructors. They had listened to what the instructor said. Somebody should have said amen right there for Reverend Hall. They heard, they listened, and they actually lit. They were craftsmen. And whenever something has become your craft or you've become real good at it, that in itself is motivation. I was sitting here just amazed at the incredible music and harmony and voices of this praise team. You guys are awesome. Say amen, somebody. Y'all ever been to Atlanta, Georgia? No, let me stop. But if you were to ask me to come and sing a song, I would be zero motivated. In fact, half of y'all would be running up out of here because that's not my craft. But ask me to come preach at morning, noon, or midnight. I'll show up because that's my craft. And when you have studied and cultivated your craft, that in itself is motivation. And graduates, this ain't the end of your cultivating your craft. I was glad to hear that Reverend Hall's going to Southwestern Baptist Seminary. The journey of learning goes on. And it doesn't matter whatever you're doing, if you're serving in church, ushers ought to continue cultivating their craft. The choir ought to continue cultivating their craft. Those who serve in whatever capacity, we ought to always be getting better and better and better at whatever God has called us to do. Stay motivated by your craft. And notice this in the text. The material that they were working on, Moses shares in verse 32, to design, to make designs for working, listen to this, in gold, and in silver, and in bronze. 33, in the cutting of stones for settings and in the carving of wood so as to perform every inventive work. They were working with gold and silver and bronze. Now they had to be excellent in their craft because, listen, the materials were so precious. You could not do carving in gold, make a mistake, throw it away, and start over again. Trust me, you had to get it right the very first time. Now let me share this. The material that you all will be working with, the material that you all are called to work with, that the Holy Spirit will control you to work, that you have spent years at the College of Biblical Study cultivating your craft to work with, the material you'll work with is far more precious than any gold, silver, or bronze. Why? Because you're going to work with God's people. And you always determine the value of something. How? By the price that you're willing to pay for it. And we all know the price that God paid for people. Yes. Am I right about it? John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever should believe on him should not perish, but have eternal life. Be motivated by your call. Motivated by the control of God's precious Holy Spirit. Be motivated by the craft. You've learned it. You're skilled. Be ready to utilize those skills for the glory of God. But lastly, as I take my seat, I only observe the call and the control and the craftsmanship of this text. Lastly, I notice the companionship. Because there's evidence in this text that Bezalel did not have to do the work that God called him to do, gave his spirit to help him do, gave him a craft to do the assignment well, Bezalel did not have to do it all alone. Verse 34 says, he has put in his heart to teach. Before 34, all the pronouns are singular. In verse 34, there's the introduction of a new person. He says, look, he has put in his heart to teach both he and Aholiab. In other words, you ought to be motivated, listen, because what God calls you to do, he's going to give you some companions to do it with. Anybody here glad they ain't got to do God's work all by themselves? And I don't know about you, but I'm excited every morning I get up at Carver College because of the quality folk I have aside me to work with. Yeah, you're going to have a team of people that God will give you that you will have as companions to work with. And that's something to be excited about. So whenever graduates, you get weary, whenever you feel like throwing a towel in, just remember God called you. God will control you. God will help you cultivate your craft. And God will give you some companions. And if that is true for Bezalel, it's true for us. But guess who also it was true for? It was true for Jesus. Am I right about it? Because the old preacher would say he was called down through 40 and two generations. Stepped on the running boards of glory. Am I right? Anybody here know Jesus was called? And I know he was controlled because of Matthew 3, I see the Spirit of God landing on him like a dove. And think about it, if Jesus needed the Spirit to do the work of the Father through him, do we need to have a meeting or discussion about whether or not we need the Spirit for us to do the work of God? And we know he cultivated his craft. Because at the age of 13 to 30, all the text says is he grew in wisdom and in stature of men. And anybody here know Jesus, if anybody could have done it all by himself, it would have been Jesus the Christ. But I see Jesus doing it with some companions. Selected 12 men. And y'all know he really had more than 12. Jesus had a band of believers to work alongside of him. And I believe he was excited about the companionship that he enjoyed doing the Father's work here on earth. Stay motivated, graduates, by the call of God. Stay motivated, graduates, by the control of the Holy Spirit. Stay motivated, graduates, by the craft you've cultivated here at the College of Biblical Studies. And graduates, stay motivated by the companions God's gonna give you to work alongside of. God bless you. God bless you.
Thank you so much. That's excellent. Please join me in thanking Reverend Dr. Robert Wayne Crummy Sr. for his excellent commencement address. Today, our hearts are overflowing with excitement and gratitude as we get to recognize our associate and baccalaureate commencement ceremony for these candidates. In the middle of the program, you will see their names listed for graduation. As mentioned in our program, our associate candidates will go first, followed by our candidates for our bachelor's program. Three of our candidates are graduating with both degrees today. Raymond Awe, you've already heard from Clement Hall, and Ricky Williams will be receiving both their associate and their bachelor's degrees today. Congratulations. Some associate and baccalaureate candidates have received certain grade point averages that warrant some additional recognition of graduating with honors. Associate candidates graduating with any honors designation are distinguished by the wearing of a red honors cord with a regalia. Bachelors of Science graduates graduating with any honor designation are recognized with a gold medal with their regalia. And veterans and first responders who have served our community and country have a red, white, and blue cord. Officers and student ministries also have a special stole. Here at CBS, we desire for our graduation to have a balance of dignity and celebration. You've all been to a graduation where people say, well, please hold all your applause until the last graduate goes through. We don't ask you to do that here at CBS. We want you to recognize the graduates. We want you to cheer for them and recognize each and every one of them as they cross the stage. However, you've also gone to graduations where people have air horns and they're walking up in the aisles and taking a bunch of pictures. We don't do that here either. It is a celebration, but it is also a celebration with dignity. So we want to recognize them. We want to make sure each graduate is recognized as they go across the stage. We have arranged, the graduates will be coming from my left to your right. We have arranged official photos and videotaping. However, I know some of you want to have your own photos. And so we have roped off a section right over here where you can come and take your own photo. And it's just right behind the official graduation photo, so it's a good place. So if you would like to take your own photos, we ask you to just go to that section that's roped off right here and only to that section. Now, I know that there are some of you that think that there's an exception to that rule. There are no exceptions to that rule, mom or grandma or sister or cousin. That section right there. And so we ask you to go to that section to please take your photos and to please respect all of the friends and families of graduates so they could all have a view of their candidate as they walk across the aisles. Today we are honoring the recipients of the Associate of Biblical Studies in Spanish as well as English. Since the Associate of Biblical Studies is in Spanish and English, I will translate portions of this ceremony for the benefit of the Associate of Biblical Studies candidates and their guests. Hoy nosotros honramos a nuestros estudiantes que han completado el Asociado de Estudios Bíblicos del Colegio de Estudios Bíblicos. Puesto que el Asociado de Estudios Bíblicos es ofrecido en inglés y español, voy a traducir esta porción de la ceremonia para el beneficio de los que reciben el Asociado de Estudios Bíblicos y para sus familias. The Associate of Biblical Studies is a 70-hour degree program in English and in Spanish that is designed for Sunday school teachers, missionaries, and lay leaders in churches. We also have an Associate of Arts that is 63 hours that is only in English. El Asociado de Estudios Bíblicos es un programa de 70 créditos en Biblia, Teología, en Inglés y Español que es diseñado para maestros de escuela dominical, los misioneros y líderes laicos en las iglesias. Today we are going to recognize the graduation of this fine group of 19 associate candidates. Please allow me just a minute to brag on this group of people. Y ahora que estamos a punto de presenciar la graduación de nuestra excelente clase de 19 candidatos para Asociado de Estudios Bíblicos, permítame un breve momento para hablarles de este grupo especial de hombres y mujeres. Many of our graduates have labored up to 7 years to complete their associate's degree, which incidentally is the same amount of time for the tribulation period. Among this group, we have muchos de estos graduados han trabajado hasta 7 años para completar su título de asociado. We have in this group 3 senior pastors, 4 associate pastors, 1 person in children's ministry, 2 in teaching ministry, 2 in outreach ministry, 1 in music ministry, 2 in counseling ministry, 2 in women's ministry, and 1 in military ministry. 75% are ethnic minorities. They all deserve our respects as they serve as models of truly committed followers of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Dentro de este grupo hay 3 pastores principales, 4 pastores asociados, 1 en el Ministerio de Niños, 2 en el Ministerio de Jóvenes, 2 en el Ministerio de Mujeres, 2 en el Ministerio de Consejería, 2 en el Ministerio de Enseñanza, 2 en el Ministerio de Alcance, 2 en el Ministerio Militar y 1 en el Ministerio de Música. 75% de estos estudiantes son minorías étnicas. Todos ellos merecen nuestro respeto porque ellos sirven como módulo de discípulos de nuestro Señor Jesucristo, realmente comprometidos. The Reverend Franz Brown Jr. and Dr. Nicholas Allen will be calling out the names of our graduates. I would like to ask them both to stand now and approach the stage so we can recognize them. Let's give them a hand, please. El Reverendo Franz Brown y Dr. Nicholas Allen irán llamando los nombres de los graduantes. Le pediré a ellos vengan a la plataforma para que podamos reconocerlos. I would not only like to ask that our board chair of the College of Biblical Studies, Dr. Ivory Varner, to please come join me. Ahora me gustaría pedir del Colegio de Estudios Bíblicos, el director de la Junta Directiva, Dr. Ivory Varner, que por favor se una a mí de pie. Will the candidates for graduation with an Associate's of Biblical Studies degree please rise? Mr. Board Chair, I am pleased to certify on behalf of the faculty that these students, including those in absentia, have met the necessary prerequisites, have completed the required work at the College of Biblical Studies Houston, and are candidates for the Associate of Biblical Studies and Associate of Arts degrees.
Upon the recommendation of the faculty, I, as Board Chair of College of Biblical Studies of Houston, by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees, in accordance with the laws of the state of Texas, hereby confer to the graduate students the Associate of Biblical Studies degree with all the rights, honors, and privilege attached thereof. Congratulations.
Our ushers will now escort the associate students to the stairs on my left that lead up to the stage. As they proceed to the stage, we would like to present a video that describes the College of Biblical Studies.
As we celebrate 40 years of truth, training, and transformation, the College of Biblical Studies has experienced a lot of change. From a small, one-room Bible institute to becoming Houston's accredited Bible college. Students at CBS learn to understand the Bible and its truth in such a way that it changes their lives forever. Families are changed. Communities are transformed. Over 25,000 students have attended CBS to experience this power of transformation. So how about you? Do you have a desire to change your world? Come see for yourself what transformation looks like.
We now recognize Clement Hall. Raymond Awe. Ricky Williams, Sr. Guadalupe Cocker. Lemuel Duran. Ruth Edwards. Oh. Paula D. Esperanza. Adriana Espinoza. Ethan Lee. Ronald Lewis.
Artemisa.
Artemisa Lopez. Raja Antonio Mahia. Teresa De Jesus Mahia. Brian Nettles. Brandon Oliver. Cedric Penn. Jury W. Simeon. Juan Sola. Emma Todd. Kathy Young. Rena Esther Zalia.
Let's give our associate candidates a round of applause. In addition, we're also recognizing an outstanding group of students marking the completion of their Bachelor's of Science degree program. Over the years, these candidates for Bachelor's of Science degree have labored and stand today having finished well. Hoy también somos testigos de un grupo destacado de estudiantes que completan su programa de licenciatura. En los últimos años, estos 33 candidatos para el título de licenciatura en ciencias han trabajado y están hoy aquí terminando bien. The College of Biblical Studies offers Bachelor's of Science degrees in Biblical Studies and Biblical Counseling, as well as Biblical Studies and Christian Leadership, both in English and in Spanish, and we're recognizing the Spanish graduates for the first time. And those are in our Accelerated Degree Completion Program. We also have a Bachelor's of Science in Organizational Leadership, Women's Ministries, and Biblical Studies with minors in Christian Leadership, Biblical Studies, Pre-Seminary, Christian Education, Pastoral Ministries in our degree program. And as was mentioned earlier, today we are also recognizing our first graduates, our Bachelor's of Science degree in Women's Ministry. El Colegio de Estudios Bíblicos ofrece el título de licenciatura en Ciencias en Estudios Bíblicos, Consejería Bíblica, Liderazgo Cristiano en Inglés y Español en nuestro programa acelerado de finalización de título y el título de licenciatura en Ciencias de Liderazgo Organizacional, Ministerios de Mujeres y Estudios Bíblicos con concentración secundaria en liderazgo, Consejería Bíblica, Preseminario, Educación Cristiana y Ministerios Pastorales. Typically, commencement ceremonies honor graduates who are getting started in their ministry craft, as Dr. Crummy mentioned. However, CBS is proud to have many graduates who have already embarked on their ministry, and they came to College of Biblical Studies to sharpen their effectiveness in ministry. They come to sharpen their effectiveness so they can expand the impact of their ministry. Típicamente, las ceremonias de graduación honran a los graduados y anticipan un comienzo de sus carreras después de recibir su título. CBS engordece que la mayoría de nuestros estudiantes ya se encuentran activamente involucrados en posiciones y ocupaciones de ministerio. Ellos no vienen a CBS para que puedan iniciar su ministerio, ellos vienen para que puedan expandir el impacto de sus ministerios. With that in mind, let me tell you a little bit about our candidates of distinguished group of men and women. Con ese pensamiento en mente, permítame alardear un poquito sobre el distinguido grupo de hombres y mujeres. Here is just a sampling of the duties these bachelor's candidates are currently undertaking. Aquí hay solo un ejemplo de los deberes que estos candidatos a la licenciatura están llevando a cabo actualmente. 6 are senior pastors. 6 son pastores principales. We have 1 pastor, un pastor. 4 associate pastors. 4 pastores asociados. 7 assistant pastors. 7 asistentes de pastor. 3 in children's ministry. 3 en ministerio infantil. 6 in teaching ministry. 6 en ministerio de la enseñanza. 3 in outreach ministry. 3 en alcance ministerial, 5 in music ministry, 5 en ministerio de música, 5 in women's ministry, 5 en ministerio de mujeres, 3 in missions ministry, 3 en ministerio de misiones, 2 in prayer ministry, 2 en ministerio de oración, 4 in youth ministry, 4 ministerio de jóvenes, 2 in connection group ministry, 2 en ministerio de grupos de conexión, 1 in social services and communication ministry. 1 en Ministerio de Servicio Social y Comunicación, and 1 in General Ministry, 1 en un Ministerio General. In case you're doing the math, we have multiple graduates that are involved in multiple ministries. 86% are ethnic minorities, 47% are women, 67 intend to attend graduate school in the future. The ages of our bachelor's candidates range from 22 to 72 years old, proving it's never too late to start at the College of Biblical Studies. 86% son minoría étnica, 47% son mujeres, 66% pretenden asistir a una escuela de posgrado en el futuro. El rango de las edades de estos nuestros candidatos licenciaturas son 22 a 72 años, demostrando que nunca es demasiado tarde para asistir a CBS. I would like now to now ask our board chair of the College of Biblical Studies, Dr. Ivory Varner, to please come and join me again. Ahora quisiera pedir al presidente de Junta Directiva del Colegio de Estudios Bíblicos, Dr. Ivory Varner, que se una a mí de nuevo. Will the candidates for graduation with a Bachelor of Science degree please rise? Mr. Board Chair, I am pleased to certify on behalf of the faculty that these students, including those in absentia, have met the necessary prerequisites, have completed the required work at the College of Biblical Studies Houston, and are candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree.
Upon the recommendation of the faculty, I, as Board Chair of College of Biblical Studies Houston, by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees, and in accordance with the laws of the State of Texas, hereby confer to the graduate students the Bachelor of Science degree with all the rights, honors, and privilege attached thereto. Congratulations.
Now our ushers will escort the baccalaureate students to the stairs on my left that lead up to the stage. While they're going, the song by Twyla Paris, How Beautiful, will play. Just as a bride is adorned for her wedding day, the body of Christ is as well. Many of our graduates come to the College of Biblical Studies from other nations as depicted by the flags displayed, most of our graduates have prepared their entire life for this moment. We are proud of our graduates who are the hand and feet of Jesus, who take the sound of good news and love of the King all over the earth.
Graduating with a bachelor's degree, Clemen Hall. Raymond Ah. Ricky Williams, Sr. Willie Adams, Jr. Brandy Adiokun. Howard Agnew. Margaret Allen Adeagra. Autumn Rose Black. Gabriel Cardenas. Jose Carmona. Gregory Ferris Collins. Maria Letitia Cruz. Ruben Cruz.
Michael A. Davis. Sophia Garcia. Vicki A. McGathan Harrison. Neftali Hernandez. Theodora Skinner Jackson. Mark Anthony James. Brian Johnson. Christopher Johnson. Dorothy Marie Edwards Kirk. Harry Kirkpatrick. Vivian Lacayo. Arnegra Lacey. Nora Lida. Congratulations. Thank you so much. Sheila Martin. Gabriel Martinez. Roderick McCartney Sr. Samantha Elizabeth Lewis. Okay, all right. Samantha Elizabeth Louise Medina. Michael Moses.
Yeah. Give me this. I'm so happy for y'all.
Yes. Yeah. Jacqueline Nunez.
Daisy Parada. Caleb Pettigrew. Kevin Pineda.
Congratulations.
Natividad Rabago.
Christina Rivera. Okay. Rivera.
Christina Rivera. Myra Sandoval.
Congratulations. Deborah, is it Liza? Somoana.
Yes, Liza.
Liza?
Somoana.
Somoana. Okay, speak. Okay. Here we go.
Deborah Liza Samuano Spears.
Congratulations. I'm going to mess it up. No.
Penny Suber. Anna Umanzor.
Nah, you know my name. You don't need no clown. You don't need no clown, man. Come on, you know my name. I did it right. He's Odiales. Okay, here we go.
Jesus Odiales.
David Valdez.
David Valdez.
You got this thing done, man.
Thank you, sir.
You got this thing done. Yes, indeed.
Corey Williams. Erica Wilson.
Let's give them a hand. Graduates, we have one more piece of business which we need to take care of. Will the graduates of the Associates of Biblical Studies programs, as well as the Associates of Arts, and the graduates of Biblical Studies programs, please rise? You have these tassels and they're on the wrong side. So they're on your right side and we got to get them over to the left side to indicate that you're a graduate. So at my signal, I'm going to ask you in unison to shift your tassel from the right side to the left side as the final symbolic act of your academic accomplishment and your graduation. Please rise. You can stand up. Pueden pararse. So, on the count of three, so if your tassels are on your left, make sure you have it on your right. On the count of three, you will move it from your right to your left. One, two, three. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to present to you the 2017-18 graduating class of the College of Biblical Studies.
Thank you. You can be seated. My name is Dr. Mike Ayers, and I'm a professor. Professor of Leadership Studies here at CBS, and it is my joy and privilege on behalf of the faculty to lead in a prayer of dedication to you, our graduates here this year. And I want to ask our faculty to please encircle the graduates as you remain seated, please. And I want to ask the faculty to reach out, place their hands on the shoulders of those nearest you. Gentlemen, yes, please remove your caps. And graduates, I want to ask you to join hands with your brother or sister in Christ next to you. Before we pray, I just want to say on behalf of this faculty how proud we are of you, how much we love you. We know how much work that you have done. We've assigned it, so we know. And you've finished the race that God has called you up to this point. And there's a race further to be run. And so let's pray and let's commit this race to the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, I pray on behalf of our faculty for these graduates that they would spend their lives in service to the King, that they would lead as servants. Father, I pray that it would be their prayer that they would say to you, they would pray to you, I give myself away that you may use me. Change our prayers from God bless me to God use me. Help them, Father, to fight the good fight, to run the race, to keep the faith. And may we look to that day when the Lord, the righteous judge, will deliver unto us a crown of righteousness. So help us, God, from now till then, to run with perseverance the race that's set before us. Father, bless these graduates. Continue to use them in their ministries. Help them to be lifelong learners. Father, I pray that you would protect them from the schemes of the evil one who would seek to devour, to divide, to detract them from the ministry that you've called them to. Oh, Father, give them every resource that they need, every emotional resource, every spiritual resource, every relational resource, God. As we heard today, provide for them every strength that they need through the power of your Holy Spirit. We commend them as faculty unto you, and we commend them unto the ministry of your word. And so now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus for all generations, forever and ever. And as the body of Christ, we pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. 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 God bless you all. We love you. God bless you.
I would like to introduce Dr. Lisa Stewart, who will be announcing the recipients of the Delta Epsilon Chi Honor Society Awards. The purpose of the Delta Epsilon Chi Honor Society is to encourage and honor graduates from accredited institutions of the Association of Biblical Higher Education by recognizing outstanding academic scholarship, approved Christian character, and Christian leadership ability. Me gustaría presentarles a doctora Lisa Stewart, quien anunciará a los receptores de los galardones de la Sociedad Honorífica Delta Epsilon Chi. El objetivo de la Sociedad Honorífica Delta Epsilon Chi es alentar y honrar a los graduados de las instituciones acreditadas
de la Asociación para la Educación Superior Bíblica mediante el reconocimiento de la beca académica sobresaliente, el carácter cristiano aprobado y la capacidad de liderazgo cristiano.
Congratulations, graduates. We're very proud of you. Hello. Hello, my name is Dr. Lisa Stewart. I'm the Associate Vice President of Enrollment and Student Services and also serve as Dean of Students. Today is a very special day because it represents the culmination of a great deal of hard work in your studies. However, today is also the commencement that begins a new relationship for you graduates to CBS. You are now an alumnus with all the rights and privileges therein. The College of Biblical Studies is very proud of your accomplishments. Today, a select few of our baccalaureate graduates will be inducted into the Delta Epsilon Chi Honor Society. No more than 7% of our graduates may be nominated and selected in any given year. The CBS Faculty Committee selected the following three honorees who met the criterion of exhibiting Christian character, leadership ability, and have at least a cumulative GPA of 3.3 on a 4-point scale or its equivalent. I will ask the honorees to come to the stage individually when their name is called to accept their award from me, along with their Delta Epsilon Chi certificate. The individuals who are receiving this award are not aware of it until now. The first honoree is Howard Agnew. Please come to claim your certificate and your pen. The second honoree is Gregory Ferris Collins. Please come and claim your certificate and pen. The third honoree is Ruben Cruz. Please come to claim your certificate and pen. The fourth honoree is Gerald Dolphus, and Gerald was unable to attend the commencement ceremony, so we will present his to him later. The fifth honoree is Jacqueline Nuez. Please come to claim your certificate and pen. The sixth honoree is Daisy Parara. Please come and claim your certificate and pen. Welcome to the Delta Epsilon Key. Please stay on the stage and let's take a picture together. So if you'll come back around. Today, we will also be announcing the honorary alumni selections for the Delta Epsilon Key Honor Society. The honorary alumni must have graduated at least 10 years ago, and there cannot be more than 3 honorary selections in any given year. 2 of our honorees are here today. The first honoree is Mr. Alfred Lord. Mr. Lord is serving as an assistant professor at Bel Air High School. Alfred. The second honoree is Pablo Munroy. After serving in Spanish ministry of Dr. Chuck Swindoll, Stonebriar Community Church, Pastor Munroy is now the Spanish pastor for Second Baptist Church in Espanol. Please come to claim your certificate and pen. The third honoree is Shirley Ralston. Shirley Ralston is working with Wycliffe Associates on their Unlock Bible Notes. She has been a missionary care ministry co-leader as well as on the research team of Houston's First Baptist Church and registrar and academic counselor at Houston Christian High School. Let's congratulate them again.
Graduates, as you work on your craft and you do excellent things, you too can be an assistant principal, a pastor, and/or a Bible translator. Want to acknowledge the wonderful alumni that God has given the College of Biblical Studies, as well as our Delta Epsilon Key recipients. Please stand for our closing hymn and then remain standing for our benediction. The candidates will recess out to the front foyer. This way. We are asking all of you to please wait to leave in order to give our candidates sufficient time to come to the front foyer. So after the candidates leave, you can then greet them, but please give us sufficient time to leave and to arrive there. I want to introduce to you Dr. Steve Sullivan, who will be providing our closing benediction before our recessional.
Let's sing our closing hymn together. Great is thy faithfulness. As the words will be found on the monitors, please lift your voice and let's declare that our God is faithful and that we will leave this place and walk and be who he's called us to be. Let's begin with verse 1. Great is thy faithfulness. Let's sing together.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee, and thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not, and as thou hast been and forever.
Let's lift the refrain.
Great is thy faithfulness, oh, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see, and all I am needed, thy hand has provided. For great
winter.
Summer and winter and springtime and harvest. The sun, moon, and stars in their courses above. We join with all nations
and the peace that endureth.
Pardon for sin and the peace that endureth. For thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Get strength for
this last time, say,
great is thy faithfulness. Oh, great is thy faithfulness. Every morning by morning, new
afternoon. Great is thy faith. Oh, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto thee.
May we stand in awe of him as we are standing. The one who's the sovereign sustainer of the universe, who beckons us by his Spirit to answer the call of his mission. Let's pray. Oh God, renew our minds from the polluted thoughts, our affections from the love of idols, our character from the stain of sin, and our conversation from the idle words. Take us captive by your majesty, woo us by your word, delight us with your mission, and satisfy us with your glory. Only then, and to the degree that this happens, will we really answer your call. Thus, may we be careful never to steal your glory, find your cross to be our crown, desire your commission to be our foremost vocation, that our life may magnify the glorious majesty of the Master in the ministry. Now, the God of peace, who brought us up from the dead, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord, equip you in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.